I'm joined on this very special episode of Just Enough Trope, which, by the way, I am your host, Caliban, and I'm here to bring you all the news that's fit to cast in the world of nerdy entertainment. I have a special guest star on the show today. He's actually been on our sister show, Enterprising Individuals. He is author and editor Scott Pearson. Scott, say hello.
Hello.
Perfect. You can take commands. Welcome to the show and for helping out right now.
Sure.
Your original series ebook, Star Trek, the original series ebook, The More Things Change, is available on Amazon and wherever you can get those electronic books.
Those fancy newfangled gadgets.
Sure. And you are no stranger to podcasting because you are the host of a podcast yourself, Generations Geek.
Indeed I am, along with my daughter.
Yes, on the Chronic Rift Network.
Correct.
What do you cover on Generations Geek?
We talk about all things geeky. We kind of...
Ooh, so do we.
Yeah,
are we competitors?
Wow. I guess
should
so.
Should you be on the show?
In this cutthroat world of podcasting.
Yes.
Where it's so many... There's only so many advertiser dollars to go around.
Right, exactly. Yeah, right,
for,
yeah.
The lucrative income we have off our podcasts. we kind of split our time between just... You know, watching some movies and talking about them, or having on guests, cool geeky guests, people that we know, and
right,
yeah.
What kind of guests have you had?
We've had a number of my fellow Star Trek writers on as guests: David Mack, Kirsten Beyer, who's now on staff at the new Star Trek Discovery TV show.
Yes, of course.
We've also had some other cool people. We had Thomas D. Jones, who flew 3 space shuttle missions.
Oh,
so,
wow.
An actual astronaut that we had on the show, and we had him on twice, once to just talk about the fact that he's an amazing, you know, he's an astronaut, he's been in space.
Right.
And and then we also had him back on to talk about the film Gravity and what they got right and wrong
in
portraying, you know, the science of it.
Right.
And one of our bigger scores was before he came a super rock star in the geek world, Andy Weir, author of the novel The Martian.
Okay, yeah, right.
We had him on the show just shortly before the book came out.
Before it, okay. Oh, all right, I see. Okay.
When there were just sort of rumors that it was going to be made into a movie, but nothing was final yet.
Sure. And he had, I think I remember listening to that show. There was an interesting, he had an interesting story about how that book came out, which was like, he was just giving it away, basically, to anybody.
It
who would
is
it.
The most crazy, come out of nowhere story. Yeah, he originally published it in HTML, chapter by chapter, on his website.
Oh, right. Okay.
And then people were really liking it, and they were telling him, you know, it's kind of annoying trying to read this on a browser. You should put out an ebook. So he made an ebook and put it on Amazon and for 99 cents just because you have to charge something
right.
on Amazon. And then it really started drawing a lot of attention, and then the right people saw it and said, well, we'd actually like to put this out as an actual book, a print book.
Yeah.
And then, you know, suddenly it's a Ridley Scott movie with Matt Damon.
I know, it's incredible.
And now he's written another script for Ridley Scott, and apparently he's just recently sold some sort of a sci-fi TV pilot.
Oh, really? Wow.
So he's just come from, you know, nerdy guy doing his HTML coding.
Right,
to
yeah.
The top of the geek.
Not giving that stuff away anymore. Well, that's really great. I know that you have been a nerd for a long time and a Star Trek fan for a long time, and I should warn you, we get in trouble sometimes when we talk about Star Trek on this show, because some people like Star Trek. Not everybody wants to hear about Star Trek all the time. I almost killed the show.
That's fine with me.
When we decided to do a full Star Trek films rewatch from the motion picture through to beyond, and we had a lot of fun doing that, but yeah, the listener numbers kind of went woo. So. So we'll talk about Star Trek a little bit on the show today. We should probably just front load it and get it out of the way. I wanted to hear your opinion about what, you know, the new Star Trek Discovery show that you mentioned previously, and how do you think it's going? What do you expect to see from it?
Boy, I don't know what to expect. It's very interesting to me, especially now that there's been this casting announcement that there's a guy playing Sarek on the show.
Right.
So the idea that Sarek might be some sort of recurring character, I find very exciting.
Yeah.
I've liked the casting news that I've seen so far, but you know, there's so little that we actually know
right.
about the show, other than, you know, it's set before the original series by a few years, and these are some of the people that have been cast.
Right.
But I'm excited. The people that are working on it are cool. You know, they worked on.
They arrive on motorcycles every day.
They you know, I don't know if you're familiar with the show Pushing Daisies.
Sure. Yeah.
Which was such an interesting, unique, amazing show.
Yeah.
And it's the crew from that. And then of course my friend
quirky Star Trek, then it's going to be,
and
quirky.
So I'm hoping it, yeah, maybe not bursting into song quirky, but
maybe they get Chief McBride on there to play an admiral,
yeah,
or something.
Yeah. But then, and of course I've got my personal connection. That's fun because my friend Kirsten is on there, mm-hmm, and as on the writing staff. And, so I'm very hopeful. I'm excited.
Yeah, I am as well. Did you see the sort of recent, very short kind of teaser that they put out?
Yep, the sort of flash reel kind of thing.
Yeah, uniforms kind of like Enterprise a little, like kind of jump blue and jumpsuity and some more Klingon stuff. And so, yeah, if they, I'm excited too. If they just keep pushing it back, though, we may never see it. So they might actually reach the 23rd century before we do.
They have had some speed bumps along the way, but I'd rather have them push it back then rush it out.
Yeah.
You know, because that happens sometimes in both in film and television and in publishing. There are sometimes people get stuck onto a hard release date and it just has to come out by that date for various reasons.
Right.
And then sometimes you can really tell that something has been rushed.
Sure.
So I'd rather let them age it properly in the cask or whatever metaphor I want to use.
Right. Romulan ale cask or something. I agree. And it seems like they're really committed, you know, probably because it's a great property, but also because they want it to be sort of an anchor for CBS All Access as well. So
yeah.
I don't think they can really back out at this point.
No, they've got a lot riding on this.
Yeah, yeah.
And, well, interestingly, way back in the day, before Star Trek The Motion Picture, when they were first thinking of doing a new Star Trek series, mm-hmm, called Star Trek II.
Right, right.
That was at one point going to be used to launch another television network.
Oh, Paramount Network.
Yeah. And, okay, of course, that all...
Right. We didn't get that
fell apart
for years.
Yeah.
I'm also curious to know if you know anything about or if you have been looking forward to the crowdfunded DS9 documentary that Ira Stephen Bear is doing.
I'm very excited about that. I haven't been following it really closely, but I know it's out there, and I'm not even sure now... Is it just about done? I can't remember what the release date is.
I think it is just about done, yeah. The thing that and a lot of fans are probably looking forward to is that I guess a section of it is going to be they've got the writing team back together and they're going to sort of pitch a season 8.
Where
the characters would have gone after the end of the series.
Yeah, and it'll be really interesting to see what sort of ideas they pitch and compare that to the novel line and where they went post-family.
Yeah, right, yeah. And hopefully they'll take it seriously, and they're not just doing an improv game or something like that. And then they do this. We'll get into what we're going to talk to about on the show today. We're actually doing our Craft to Services segment on the show today, which is a segment where we talk about films that critics hated but audiences have generally loved. The one we're doing in this case is Resident Evil, the brainchild, I suppose you could say, of Paul W.S. Anderson. Who is, he's become, he's got quite the schlock pedigree at this point. He's
There's
done
a
quite
hilarious
a few of these
line
movies.
on the Wikipedia page about him. It says something about known for producing, bombs that...
that make a lot of money.
Yeah.
Or at least make their investment back. And I know that you are a fan of the series. It's a guilty pleasure of yours.
Indeed.
So.
My secret shame.
Well, it's not secret anymore. The whole world's going to know.
That and the Underworld
Who like Len Wiseman is like the Betamax to Paul W.S. Anderson's VHS. They're kind of birds of a feather. So when we're talking about that, we'll also be talking about some of the news of the nerd, and we're going to do that right now. You're a nerdy TV fan. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Do you watch a lot of those shows like Arrow, The Flash?
I watch all of those shows.
Oh, great, great.
And, I mean, it's getting crazy because there's more and more and more of them.
It's becoming more and more difficult. Have you seen Powerless yet?
No.
Interested in checking it out?
Yeah, I mean, there's just about any geeky TV show is something I'm interested in checking out. But,
yeah.
You know, I try to limit a little bit.
Yeah.
Because we're in such a golden age of TV.
It's, absolutely, yeah.
You know, thanks to all the, you know, Roku and, you know, where you can get Hulu and Amazon Prime. And, I mean, there's all these things. There's so many more networks. And yet, a lot of them are producing really well-crafted shows. Man in the High Castle, for instance, from Amazon Prime.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah. I guess the reviews of Powerless have not been very good. But it's on NBC is kind of where it landed, which is funny because, you know, that's not, why isn't it on CW if it's a DC property? But
yeah. Well, and the weird thing about Powerless is the show that it turned out to be, I guess, is quite a bit different than it was originally pitched.
Uh-huh.
You know, the process of getting on the air necessitated some changes or compromises. And,
yeah, right.
And so, yeah, now it's not quite getting the enthusiastic reception that people were giving it before. When the news first came out about the concept for this show, there was a lot of like, oh, my gosh, this is going to be great. And now it's kind of
watered down.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, NBC, they can ruin anything, it seems like. Well, let's move on to things that are more hopefully optimistic in the world of nerdy TV shows. It looks like Black Lightning is going to get a pilot order at the CW.
Oh, yeah.
It was originally pitched to Fox, who passed on it, and so now it's going to move home to CW, which is really the best. I don't know, you know, not a television executive. I don't know how these things end up where places they shouldn't be. Like Supergirl clearly was a CW show from the start. And I'm sure that CBS was looking to sort of broaden their base by, mm-hmm. you know, trying to get something to maybe a younger audience because they've got all a million CSI shows or whatever it is. And so that eventually ended up on CW. And so Black Lightning looks like it is going to just be starting on the CW.
Yeah, and I wonder if they're going to then tie that in.
Oh, yeah.
Because the level of
crossover. Stephen Amell will show up in the pilot, I'm sure, to be like, thumbs up, guy.
The crossover level is getting insane now, where it's just every show is linked to every. Yeah,
yeah, and it's ironic because they're trying so hard to do that in the film franchise, mm-hmm. get all these characters together, and they've already got like a B-team Justice League on the small screen right now. So I'm not sure why they can't seem to get things together on the film side. Speaking of more TV, nerdy TV sort of news, it looks like the Inhumans show will continue to be developed for ABC. I don't know if you've heard about this at all, but it's going to be shooting in Hawaii, and it's supposed to be bigger than Lost. They've, like, building sets already, and they've, done all the casting, and they're going to try to make this thing work. It's going to come out this fall, and it's going to come out in IMAX theaters first. It's being shot in IMAX, and then it will come to television after that.
Interesting.
Now you're an Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fan.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So
I'm looking forward to this and boy, just, you know, just a couple years ago I hardly watched any TV.
Same here.
And not because I mean there's stuff that I watch and I'm not a exclusively sci-fi kind of TV watcher. I watch, you know, various shows. But then it just blew up, and in fact, I actually some of the CW shows I didn't watch for the first couple of years. I just mm-hmm. Then I started checking out Arrow, and I think that was already in its third season before I started watching any of it.
Sure,
and then I just binged through it and got caught up, and then,
right.
then all this other stuff started coming together and
right. Yeah, I mean, it's becoming to the point where they say, you know, you can't physically watch all of these shows. Like, nobody has the time to actually do it, so you have to kind of pick and choose. And we've talked about this previously on this show, but there's a Cloak & Dagger show that's going to be on Freeform Network, I think.
Oh.
It's coming up, and then...
I wasn't familiar with that one.
The very familiar, or not familiar, the very popular comic Runaways about sort of like teenage superheroes.
Mm.
Is going to be on Hulu. That's a Marvel property as well.
Wow, so. That's another one I wasn't... Yeah, I'm not a... The weird thing is, I love all these comic book TV shows and movies,
uh-huh.
but I never actually really followed any of them in the comic book world before they came on.
Right.
So they're just entirely new to me, some of them, as far as the... you know the general concept just from osmosis of the geek world, but you know, I've never read a Green Arrow comic. I've never, you know.
Yeah, it helps too that, you know, maybe by necessity of design, superheroes tend to be kind of self-explanatory.
Yeah.
I mean, his name is literally Green Arrow. So if he shows up with a blue tuba, that's not Green Arrow. The one thing I like is that maybe you don't have the time, but you can physically watch them all now because there is DVR and there's streaming services. In the old days, you had to set your watch or whatever. Yeah, and if you missed it, good luck. You might see it in syndication or on a rerun. But
Right now, I really do make an effort to keep up on all the Arrowverse shows and then on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and, you know, and all the Netflix stuff.
Yeah.
Jessica Jones and, you know, have you Luke seen Cage and all that.
The recent trailer for Iron Fist?
Actually, I haven't. I saw, you know, a link to it popped up in my feed on my, you know, but I didn't click it yet.
Right.
So I saw a little bit of that. There was something that came out from that was the Defenders, and I looked at that a little bit, but I haven't.
Okay,
I haven't looked at the.
It's safe to say you're a fan of those shows.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I enjoy them, too. The one thing that I did watch this Iron Fist one, and it looks pretty good. No, I mean, not without spoiling anything, but the one thing that I sort of lament is that, like the movies, they have a very similar visuals or a samey visual mm-hmm. style. Mm-hmm. Like, a lot of the Marvel movies kind of look the same, and if they've picked a good style, like they're colorful, yet they're sort of grounded, and it looks great, but I kind of wish it was, you know, a little more varied. Like, if we had a Power Man and Iron Fist movie set in the 70s, it'd be more kind of grainy, like blaxploitation looking film stock.
Well, but even if you compare the TV shows to the movies, I think that you know, like Daredevil is much darker, both literally and figuratively, than the movies.
Sure, yeah.
And as is Jessica Jones. I love the atmosphere that Luke Cage had, that just really, you know, just the neighborhood, the Harlem and the history and all that. They really
took
advantage of that.
I just got done criticizing it, but I would praise Cage for that visual element, because you'd think, oh, gritty, gray, urban street, but they took every opportunity they could to inject a lot of color and a lot of vibrant color that kind of invoked the idea of the sort of four color comics.
Yeah.
But was still more realistic. Yep. It didn't turn into Dick Tracy or anything like
that. Yeah. But yeah, there is a certain sameness to a lot of the Marvel films, you know, and it's, they kind of, you know, they've found their sweet spot and they're just sticking to it. And so it's kind of, you know that you're going to get you're guaranteed a certain level, minimum level of entertainment when you go to a new Marvel movie. Mm-hmm. But I agree that it would be fun to see them shake things up a little bit more.
Yeah. Well, not until the big Infinity War, probably. They can just start trying things after that. But I don't think they're going to do anything to upset what they've got going on.
No. When you're hitting them out of the park almost every time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. You don't change your favorite socks or something.
Right, yeah, exactly, yeah. Keep your rally cap on or something like that, yeah. Well, you're a film fan, too.
I just
too.
Used a sports metaphor. Yeah,
I don't even. We'll cut that out. Well, you're
one of two that I can make.
You're a film fan as well, clearly. Are you an M. Night Shyamalan fan?
Not particularly.
Have you seen his new film, Split?
No, and I'm kind of... now that I've heard some spoilers about it, I'm not going to say
that. Not on this show.
I heard a spoiler about it that makes it more interesting to me. But I had actually grown a little weary of his need to do the twist ending. I think.
Yeah.
I think that when you get, I think that limits. You know, it limits him as a director, or you know, the kind of projects he can do. If Well, I have to have a twist ending.
Right.
And just, you know, like, I'm the twist ending guy.
Yeah.
I think you set yourself up for problems
there. Yeah, but he's always going to work in a certain wheelhouse. Like, he's not going to do, like, when David Lynch did The Straight Story, and everyone's like, what's this? And then right away he goes back to Inland Empire. He's like, okay, all right, that's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, he's always going to be working in that kind of area.
Yeah, yeah. So, I don't know. I've enjoyed some of his work. A lot of it I haven't seen because, you know, once I see the previews and start hearing about it, it just seems like it's not quite my bag.
Yeah, well, I would agree. I mean, the reason I bring it up is because I see dead careers coming back to life. Split is doing gangbusters. They've made about $100 million on their $9 million budget. And that comes after his movie last year, The Visit, which did similar business. It was a $5 million budget, made about $100 million domestically. So he's back. And my question is, these are produced by Blumhouse Productions that make the Paranormal Activities and those sort of lower budget films. Was he sort of a low budget scare guy this whole time, masquerading as a tentpole guy? Because the Sixth Sense was, I don't know how much it cost, but Bruce Willis probably jacked the price up a little, but it's a pretty small film.
Yeah.
And then he's doing The Happening, and then all these things are happening or aren't happening. And maybe this has always been like where he should be, like making these smaller kind of spookum.
Yeah, I think that's a fair concept. I mean, in some ways,
or The Last Airbender.
If didn't see it, never will.
Yeah, I actually kind of want to see it now just to know the
morbid curiosity.
The level of crapitude.
Well, yeah, I'm a huge fan of the animated series, and so I as soon as I saw that they were trying to do the whole thing in one movie and. You know, it just clearly, it's like, I don't know, seemed ill-conceived from the beginning. But I haven't seen it, so I should limit my comments. But, you know, I wonder if Sixth Sense hadn't blown up like it did, he probably would have had a much easier career because there wouldn't have been the expectation that he's got a follow up.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And get something that huge every time. That's a bad thing about the industry is that there is an incredible amount of pressure on someone.
Oh, certainly.
After they, you know, really knock one out like Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
Which I think is a really nicely crafted film, and it's got a twist ending that holds up if you go back and rewatch it.
Sure.
It all works and makes sense all the way through the film, and that's the thing that I find lacking in a majority of films that try to have a twist ending is that when you go back and watch them after you know the twist ending, you see where all the seams are.
Right. And you're just sort of waiting for the twist to come.
That try to make it hold together until you get to the big aha moment at the end.
Right.
But when you watch Sixth Sense, well, it all works. It's, you know, it's not forced. It's like it all works. And when you watch the scenes over again and you realize the secret, then you just see how brilliantly that conceit has worked through the whole film.
Yeah, and they're all relevant to what's going on with the characters or the character of Bruce Willis's character, because they aren't just, oh, something else happens, it's weird, and then we find out that twist. This whole time, it's about him not being able to let go. And he sees his wife slipping away, and we think that it's because they're being separating, but he's literally dead, and she's trying to forget him, and he won't let her.
And so it works.
There's more context once you know. Well. Yeah.
But I think if you go back and watch, like, you know, what was the one where out in the woods, and it turns out it's modern day?
The Village,
The Village.
Who cares?
You know, it's just
I kind of wanted it to be a monster in the woods. That's kind of more interesting. Yeah,
it doesn't. Yeah, it. You don't get the same resonance when you go back and watch it again when you know what's happened.
Yeah, but I mean, I think maybe he kind of, you know, left the reservation a little bit. But you can't. It's hard to blame a guy who makes The Sixth Sense and then it makes Unbreakable. I could see how we can get a Lady in the Water out of that guy, because at some point he thinks, "Why everything I touch turns to gold? I can't do any wrong here. I'm going to write myself into this movie."
Yeah.
So don't do that. Don't write yourself into a movie. Well, speaking about movies and speaking about some failures as far as movies go, I don't know if you are a World War Z fan, but World War Z 2 has been pulled from Paramount's schedule.
Yeah, I've been reading. I've been following this because I really enjoyed the first one.
Uh-huh.
And as your listeners probably know, it was a very troubled shoot.
Oh, yes. We've talked about it on the show before.
And yet, you know, the thing that came out, it was a very entertaining film. And so I was kind of excited about a potential sequel because it's, you know, there's room for it there.
Yeah.
And the idea that you got David Fincher saying, I want to do this.
Yeah, David Fincher is like, hey,
and
you guys lose your director?
Like, and it's like, well, I mean, yeah, I'm I would like to see a David Fincher World War Z movie, definitely.
Just thinking about the way that David Fincher or at least the film vocabulary we use in zombie movies, and we're going to get to this when we talk about our movie segment, which is like hyperkinetic and probably a lot of shaky cam and Dutch angles and things like that, horror tropes. That's so not Fincher. Like, everything is so geometric for him. You know, that camera is locked down, and maybe there's a move or two. And so I would like to see how he does zombies simply for that reason. Maybe Brad Pitt will just be having conversations with the zombies, like in a shot-reverse shot kind of way.
Yeah.
Also, they've dropped Friday the 13th from their schedule as well. So I'm not sure what's going on at Paramount Pictures, but they're shaking things up, it looks like.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm not worried about not getting another Friday the 13th reboot. This would be, what, the second or third reboot?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, at least. but still, I mean, it would, people would go to see it. It'd be a cash cow for them.
Yeah, well, there's certainly a dedicated, you know, fan base out there for the genre and that particular franchise.
Right.
So it is weird that they're having all these second thoughts on these.
Yeah, there are people who will just go see certain movies, whether or not they're any good. But we are going to talk about Resident Evil later on in the show. One more thing I wanted to mention. I think, have you guys talked about Dread, the movie Dread, on your podcast?
No. Did not see
that. Have you? You have not seen Dread?
No.
Oh, it is really great as far as another comic book film goes. Yeah. And Carl Urban, of course, who plays Dr. McCoy in the new Star Trek movies, plays Dread. And it's a pretty great... Well, I would say it's a very inventive and very complete adaptation of the character to the screen. Anybody who read the old 2000 AD comics knows that it was super violent, but it also was very humorous as well,
because
it was satirical. And that always gets lost when you think of Dread. People are like, oh, he's going to shoot people. He is the law. And so they lose that, but they deliver a very stylistic, very good-looking movie.
Well, and then there's the unfortunate Sylvester Stallone version out there.
That for me, that's almost like so bad it's good. Sometimes I can watch that and just sort of laugh at it. But it is pretty bad, though. Well, the producer, Adi Shankar of Dread, who has been for years saying there's probably not going to be a Dread 2, Carl Urban has been trying to get a kind of grassroots thing going. He says that it could still happen now, but possibly as an animated film.
Oh, interesting.
Which, and I'm not sure who they would do that with or what it would look like, but you have to imagine with its roots as a comic book, it would probably... adapt pretty well to that.
Yeah.
If you get Carl Urban to do the voice, that could be kind of cool too. I also wanted to mention that Ed Shankar is behind the recently announced Castlevania Netflix show. You ever familiar with Castlevania?
I'm drawing a blank. I recognize the title. That I know I've read about it being on Netflix, but I'm drawing a blank on what it actually is.
It started long, long ago on the original NES system as a video game.
And
you know, it's a lot like Resident Evil, actually, in that there's about 14 different entries. None of them have anything really to do with each other. And they all are based essentially on, like, the Dracula story or hunting vampires, but they're sort of changing around a lot. And what's kind of fun about that is it's going to be on Netflix, which is neat, but Warren Ellis, the comic book writer and author Warren Ellis, will be doing the scripts for that.
And well, that is very interesting.
And pushing it forward. So, yeah. Personally, I played, like, the first... two Castlevania games, and then I don't have any real connection to the series. I mean, just things like that get too confusing for me because I try to... Even Resident Evil, the games, I enjoy those, but they're up to like 7 now, and I dropped off somewhere about 4 or 5 because I just couldn't keep it straight anymore. But yeah, to have somebody like Warren Ellis take all those elements and go, okay, here's what the story is. I'm going to collapse this into one narrative that you can follow.
Yeah, and obviously he's a guy who knows how to craft a story.
Oh, sure.
And so...
And he's a guy, too, who knows how to... pick up to work in other people's universes, like sort of pick up things and sort of shake them up and do something different with them. I always like when he gets on to a superhero book that's been going for a while. Like if he writes, let's just say Superman. I don't know if he's ever written Superman, but and he looks at, all right, he's from another planet. He's got Lois Lane, he got Jimmy Olsen. He takes all that and sort of turns it around and puts it on its ear and delivers something that you haven't seen before. Like the Resident Evil series. Should we talk about Resident Evil? Let's talk about the movie Resident Evil. Of course, it is written and directed by Paul W.S. Anderson. It was released in 2002. And the reason we're talking about it today is because it has a rating of 34% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Which I think is the highest rating of any of the films. They range from in the 20s up into the mid-30s.
Okay. But this is the best one. Wow. Okay.
I can't remember. It might be the highest one.
It is one of six films in a series, of which the most recent film, called, fittingly, Resident Evil, The Final Chapter, was released late last year.
And we are talking, these are all the live-action films starring Mila Jovovich.
Yes.
And there's also some CGI or animated films.
Yeah, that's right. And I think those ones have a little more to do with like the game storylines.
Yeah, and I haven't watched those.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never played the game, but somehow I got sucked into watching the live action movies.
And these are specifically designed to only use elements from the game and not to really connect at all. I think when they were originally developing it, and this tells you something about somebody's ego or decisions were being made, but when they originally pitched this, Capcom is the game company that owns the property. They got George Romero to write a script and to direct it. They got his script and they said, "This isn't very good. We don't like this." And they fired George Romero from a zombie movie. And then from there, they got Mr. Anderson, and he went like gangbusters from there. And it's clear that he's invested in this.
Yes, of course, Mila Jovovich is his wife.
That's right. Yes. So, he can work, he can play. It all works out. Keep it in the family. He is an interesting auteur, if I can use that word. He's done a lot of, he's done a lot of these films. He did Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
He's done the AVP movies, the Aliens vs. Predator stuff. He did a remake of Death Race, which is or is not necessary in this world, but it exists anyway. He made a...
For Death Race completists out there.
Right. Yeah.
They're going to have to see that one.
Did you see the Three Musketeers film that he did a while ago?
I did not.
I'm so tired of Three Musketeers just taking an absolute shit-kicking at the box office. Like, there's never, ever been, like, a good... Since the Richard Lester movies, there's never been, like, a good Three Musketeers movie. But this was like, we're going to add... It looks like Pan meets Three Musketeers. Like, there's going to be steampunk elements, and they're flying on a blimp. And it's like, why? Why is any of this necessary? I mean, even the Disney one was better than that. So he's a guy who... he did Soldier, too, which was a sort of unofficial follow-up to Blade Runner, or set in the same universe. So he's a guy who... I'm not sure what they call them in Hollywood, but he's definitely a guy who that kind of you hire for a certain job.
Right.
He's not going to go out there, the David Lynch's or the Shyamalan's that we were talking about before. And he's here to do a job, which is to deliver a zombie movie, to deliver a movie based on a video game. Can you give me a basic plot summary of what happens in Resident Evil?
Let's see. Well, at the most brief, so there's a company, there's an umbrella company. I mean, that's the actual name for it,
right.
Umbrella Corporation. Right. And they make all sorts of medical devices and such. And on the sly, they're making horrible weaponry, biological weapons and that sort of thing. And so they have an underground complex where they make all sorts of horrible, nasty, viral things, bioweapons and mutant monsters and such. And so in this film, you kind of get this in bits and pieces during the film because the film opens with an outbreak in the lab and it going on lockdown.
Right. And the lab is below Raccoon City. It's an underground.
The unfortunately named Raccoon City. I'm assuming that's directly from the video game.
That is exactly from the game.
And if you were making a movie adaptation...
That'd be easy to change.
Why wouldn't you, Raccoon City? But so after the breakout, then we move to the Alice, the Mila Jovovich character, who I don't think is ever even named in the movie, but
I don't think so.
I believe her name is Alice.
Yeah, it's in the credits, and that's about it, I think.
And so she wakes up after having been gassed by some sort of security system, so she doesn't have any memory of what's going on. And eventually you learn that she actually worked inside the place and is a kick-ass fighter and was trying to help bring down the corporation by smuggling out the virus. And that's all this backstory that's going on as she gets taken along with a team that's being sent down into the hive, the underground complex, to wipe out the virus and get things back online because they don't exactly know what's going on down there after right. this breakout. And so that's all the backstory set up that then just gives you an excuse for doing an hour and a half of fighting with various mutants and zombies and stuff.
Right.
And, you know, Mila Jovovich, I mean, she started out as a model, but she's a perfectly capable actress and handles the physical side of the action well. And then you've even got Michelle Rodriguez in it.
Right, right.
So Resident Evil is like the Fast and Furious of the zombie genre.
Yes, about as long-lived, too.
And she's great, and there's some other actors in there that are all right, but then you also have a lot of somewhat stilted performers.
Yeah, there's other people who maybe knew somebody or were somebody's cousin.
You know, they're given really kind of clunky dialogue that they don't have the chops to rise above, and so you just get these kind of, yes, I will do it.
Yeah, right.
Kind of line readings.
Yeah.
But you're not there to experience the acting craft.
No,
You're there to watch horrible mutants get blown up and kicked and stuff, and on that level, I just love them. I've stuck with seeing the entire series.
Yeah, I mean it's a B movie cast for a B movie basically. Yeah. And as later on, I mean we're talking about the first one, but we can talk about the other ones too. And later on, as they continue to add this cast of characters, they do get pull in some interesting actors. And Wentworth Miller is in a couple of them as the guy that plays Mr. or Captain Cold on Flash.
And Ally Lardner.
Yeah, Ally Lardner.
And Michelle Rodriguez comes back, and I can't even for the life of me remember. I mean, she was killed in the first film, so I can't even remember now if she's a different character or if she's some sort of clone or whatever.
She does that a lot in films.
Because didn't she die in Fast and Furious as well?
Right. And they go, wait a minute, you're popular. We got to bring her back. There's actually a couple rather distinguished actors in this that, like you said, they just go nowhere, do nothing, and then they're just out. Like James Purefoy plays the nominal bad guy in this, although he doesn't realize he's the bad guy until about 20 minutes from the end when he gets his memory back. Mm-hmm. And he's like a pretty big deal. He's been in a lot of movies. And then Jason Isaacs, who plays Lucius Malfoy, who's done a lot of stuff in England and a couple movies, he's the sort of whenever you hear a voiceover, he's doing the voiceover. And then end, he is a doctor character who grabs what's his name to take him off to the Nemesis program or whatever. Yeah. And so we never see his face, but that character returns in the third one, but he's played by Ian Glenn, the guy that plays Sir Friendzone on Game of Thrones.
Ah, okay.
So, yeah. So apparently he was like, I'm not going back and doing that again. No, thanks. That's fine. I want to talk about the trope or just using the mechanic of Alice not knowing who she is. Because mm-hmm. It adds an element of mystery that they never try to tackle ever again in any of the other films. They're all completely straightforward. But in this one, they're like, let's put some twist on this. Like, let's make it like a mystery sort of haunted house movie.
Well, in the opening scenes – well, not the direct opening scene. The opening scene, as I said, is the breakout in the labs.
Yes.
And some of that's kind of clunky because there are actors there that aren't really up to the task of trying to do something with the dialogue they have.
Right.
Because there's like the cliche nervous guy that starts panicking as soon as things go wrong.
Yeah, of course.
And he's very annoying, and he's supposed to be, but not quite that annoying, I think. But then when you get to the scene of Alice waking up, it's actually done fairly well.
Yeah.
This person wakes up, you know, passed out in a shower. She doesn't know what's going on. She's wandering around. She finds a notepad where there's a little note scribbled on there. And there's this great little touch where she reaches down and she writes the same thing that's on the notepad, and you realize that she's writing it to see if that's her handwriting.
Yeah.
And that's really well done. And some of the cinematography in this mansion she wakes up in is really kind of nice.
It's a great bit of visual storytelling because they don't beat it to death. If this was the game or a worse movie, she would say out loud, this isn't my handwriting.
Yeah. So, you know, it's easy to make fun of Anderson as a director.
And we will. Oh, he did Event Horizon as well, which is one of my favorite, like, kind of bad movies.
And has a very interesting troubled shoot behind that one.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. That's a whole other episode there. So I don't want to be too harsh on him. He does have some instincts that serve him well in this genre.
I also enjoyed the elevator sequence at the beginning, because it's very tense, where the lady basically gets her head chopped off by the elevator, because it's very tense, and the movie never really tries again to do anything to set, because in horror movies you have these set pieces, you're trapped somewhere, or a character has to saw their own arm off, or something like that, and it's the only time that it really tries to take a stab at something like that, and then the rest of it is just zombies slowly walking towards you. Or maybe later on when the guy's trying to get the keypad open, he finally gets it and he's like, see? And then he gets pulled away by zombies that were on the other side of the door.
Yeah.
There aren't really a lot of things like that in this, sadly.
You have these two options to go with in a horror movie, or any movie for that matter, on the soundtrack.
And which Marilyn Manson contributed to.
Yeah, and it's like either there's the more traditional symphonic soundtrack, of which I am generally a fan, and then there's the let's play loud speed metal music,
right?
Death metal
Slipknot,
music.
Yeah.
Whenever you know something happens, which is you know what Argento does, if you've watched the films of
Dario Argento.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, he's often got the speed metal stuff there. And for me, it doesn't work when it's like you want to have a very mysterious mood. You're setting up this thing, and then all of a sudden it's... And it's just... I find it grating. So that's the kind of stuff that starts blaring every time the excitement happens.
Right,
just,
right.
To me, it comes across like it's trying too hard to put you on your edge and pump up the excitement.
Right.
Although, I mean... Really, all music in movies is a cheat to manipulate emotions beyond what
the actual... But excite me. Don't keep telling me I'm excited.
But yeah, it doesn't work for me. I'm sure there are people out there that love the effect of having the metal music as a horror movie or action movie soundtrack. But
I'm a little disappointed that they didn't take the chance to do what I call like a Total Recall type thing. Because she loses her memory and she starts acting just out of instinct. Later on, she learns that... It was her plan all along, before she lost her memory, to help out the people who were trying to bring Umbrella down. And instead, they should have did like a Quaid-type thing where she was just a tool, like an asshole who was, you know, working for the corporation. But once she lost that programming, you know, or kind of reverted to her base self, then she became altruistic, sort of like Schwarzenegger in Total Recall. Because otherwise, that it makes that kind of neat thing of her losing her memory just a chance to just stretch it out farther, which could keep the mystery away from the audience until the very end, because she learns, oh no, I'm doing what I probably would have done anyway, which is helping people to take down Umbrella Corporation. There's a bunch of touches in that I think kind of get sadly subverted. Like, we meet the Red Queen, who is sort of personification of the artificial intelligence, and we learn that in, again, what is a twist or sort of a touch that really only exists in this film and none of the other films. Every other film, it's pretty straightforward. Maybe you'll meet a guy who seems really skeezy, but he's going to help you. And then later on, no, he's a bad guy, so we have to fight him. But in this, like, you find out that the AI who has killed everybody is actually doing it for good reasons, or at least logical reasons, because it's trying to keep the T-virus from getting out.
Yes.
And they shut the computer down, and it's... through no direct fault of their own, it does get out, and we get five more movies out of it. So thanks a lot, guys. But so this thing that is laser mincing and dicing everybody is actually kind of like a good guy.
Yeah.
Like, that's a neat touch.
And it's also a great touch that it's a little girl
with
a sweet little British accent saying, you're all going to die.
Right, yeah. Right. Nothing creepier than a little British girl telling you you're going to die.
And so that's great. And, oh, you mentioned the laser thing, which is, as far as a great... horror movie kind of thing. That's a great scene.
Yeah.
I mean, it gets kind of comic booky in the way it actually happens, but yeah, these lasers come through this secure hallway that goes into the computer, and they just slice and dice people. And then you get the sort of, I mean, it's the same thing that happens in the old Warner Brothers cartoons when a comic book character gets, when the cartoon character gets cut in two, they stand there for a moment and then
they fall apart.
And then their pieces.
Yeah.
And so that kind of takes away some of the horrific impact of it, but that's an effective scene.
Yeah, and I like how the one, like the team leader who's kind of a badass, he's like jumping and dodging all the things. It looks like he's going to make it out, and then the one laser turns into like a million lasers, and he's like, oh, crap.
Shit, yeah, that's it.
We talked before about Michelle Rodriguez, who's in this movie. This is 2002 must have been prime Michelle Rodriguez time. Like, I don't know when Girl Fight came out or whatever, but
they really give
her a lot of the – she's the badass in this, basically.
There's a badass character.
There's a cool guy on their little SWAT team. There's the nerdy guy. There's the leader. And she's the one who's got all the good lines, and she's kicking guys in the face.
She's got some good lines. Then she's got a lot of, you know, just the
kind of clunky lines.
You know, how many times does she say, I'm on it?
I'm on it.
Which is just, you know, the classic bad action movie line.
Right. I can't remember the character's name now. Matt, maybe? He is like the cop guy.
The cop, yes.
Yeah, he's the guy who comes in and he's
And that guy, I forgot to look him up because he's familiar. He's a guy that's been in other stuff. He's not, you know, any like great star of an actor, but
right.
He turns up in little roles here and there.
He's been on TV a lot. Eric Mabius, he was on Ugly Betty for a little while. Fun fact, David Boreanaz from Angel was going to be that character originally. But he could not make it because of his commitment to Angel. So I don't know if that would have helped the movie at all, or maybe if he would have stayed on. Hard to imagine a Resident Evil series with the guy from Angel in it. But could have been better, maybe. I'm not sure. As far as the series goes, like, there are six films. I don't think they've finished counting the money just yet on the sixth one, but they've made over $1 billion.
Yeah.
What do you think it is about these films that keep people coming back and has kept this series continuing this long, besides the love of Paul Noah?
Well, I think it's just the action. I think that he has a certain skill for putting together the action set pieces, and you know, and I think that Mila Jovovich handles herself well. Both, I guess I said this before, but I think that she's a perfectly capable actress. I mean, she's not Meryl Streep, but she's, you know,
yeah,
perfectly capable.
She's pretty good in Joan of Arc.
And, I haven't seen that one, actually. Mm. And, I mean, she really commits to the role.
Right.
You know, and that's one thing that she has done, you know, like in The Fifth Element, say.
Right.
When she's just spouting gibberish.
Yeah.
You have no doubt that she somehow, you know, that like she knows exactly what she's saying and it makes perfect sense to her. I mean, she really commits to that role in The Fifth Element, even though it's, you know, pretty thinly plotted role, obviously.
Yeah. She throws herself into it.
But she throws herself into it and...
Or off of it in The Fifth Element.
Yeah. And she's very good at the action, you know, so she really is a strong female character.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, people keep coming back. I think they like the sort of the camaraderie that develops over the series with some of the characters that recur. And, you know, it's just sometimes when you go to a movie, you're not looking to be challenged as a viewer. You're not looking for grand cinema. Sometimes you just want the Twinkie, not the
right.
You know, the
right kale like, salad.
Yeah, yeah. And it hits the right notes. You know, it doesn't try to be more than it is. Well, I guess it does try to be more than it is.
Wait,
sometimes
it tries because, to be six films long.
Because well, I meant more in the maybe not taking itself too seriously, but actually I'm stepping back on that because I think that Paul Anderson does have some pretensions as a director, and sometimes he pulls off stuff like the scene in the mansion with the billowing curtains
right.
and stuff.
Yeah.
And it has a certain artsiness to it.
Yeah.
And
other
know,
times they land a plane on a building.
And yeah.
And everybody, just, all the characters are there because that's how this is going to start.
Yeah. So I don't know. It's just good, silly fun that you don't have to worry about.
Yeah. And there's something about, I think I would characterize her performance, at least in this one and maybe in the follow-ups, as a little blank. Like, maybe like a female Keanu Reeves in that. There's just something about her, not just her like physical attractiveness, but there's just something about her that you kind of identify with her. She can look at something. It's like that film exercise where you have somebody looking at something off screen and then they show a child eating ice cream or they show an abattoir or something like that.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You project onto them. And you just, I feel like I just project onto her like what I would be thinking in this weird situation.
Yeah.
She actually was nominated for a Saturn Award for Best Actress when the movie came out. And so, and that was her only one. They got out of town after that. They're like, no more of that. The film was nominated as Best Horror Film for a Saturn Award as well. So at least early on, people were willing to kind of be like, give it a chance critically. As you mentioned, it was the highest, highest rated on the tomato meter.
Yeah. I mean, they're B movies at best, and you either have fun with it or you take it too seriously and then you hate it. But yeah, but yeah, I mean, she has a certain something to her.
Yeah.
That
certainly. Yeah, she's still around. Are there any other B movie franchises that you favor?
Well, I think I mentioned earlier the Underworld.
Sure.
That I'm actually just. Only recently have been started trying to catch up on that.
There's well, a
that,
new that, one that, that only has, out,
yeah, yeah. And I think it's only the new one is five.
Number five. Okay.
I just watched number three last week or so.
Is that the flashback one?
The one and that was the flashback one that there was no need for the flashback.
Okay.
The flashbacks that we got as actual flashbacks in the actual films
right.
was really all you needed. Devoting an entire film to the backstory, to me, well, with a different script, maybe it would have been there. But for me, I actually fell asleep while watching it, partially just because it was late at night, and I'm an old man, so I fall asleep on the couch watching TV, you know, like every old man. And but part of it was just because the film was just doing nothing for me. I just sure. was not. And so I wake up and the film's over and I was just like, oh, that disc goes back. I just put it right back in the envelope to go back to Netflix. I didn't even go back to watch the last 20 minutes.
Right. Yeah.
Because there was just no point, but it was kind of, I don't know what they were thinking on that one.
Well, they were just burning one until they could get Kate Beckinsale back, I guess.
Yeah, and that was, you know, and it was kind of, that was one of the character, the female lead in the flashback episode is almost indistinguishable from the Kate Beckinsale character.
Uh-huh.
And part of that is actually a plot point because when the head vampire, whose name escapes me, in the previous films, he was like responsible for having her whole family killed, but he didn't have her killed as a little girl.
Right.
And there's a line in there that he didn't have her killed because she reminded him of his daughter.
Okay.
So it's kind of a plot point that then his daughter should have some similarities to her.
Right, sure.
But, you know, it's like Kate Beckinsale's character's name is Celine and his daughter's character's name is some other two-syllable word that starts with an S. And they're both dressed in black all the time because they're cool vampires.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they both have, you know, short dark hair and it almost seemed like this script was written for Kate Beckinsale. And then she couldn't make it, so they just changed the name a little bit and stuck in
calculated for sure.
Rona Mitra or whatever her name
right,
is.
Right.
And who I've seen do good work in other things. I don't have anything against her, but it was an uninspired film.
It was not meant to be.
No.
I'm trying to think of something that I could bring up as in comparison that I enjoy, and everything's slipping my mind now, except I like, or I sort of hate watch 24, the television show. I don't approve of its politics. I think the hero is, you know, a scumbag, and he's a American terrorist, and he's killed more people than terrorists have ever killed. And I just have to watch every single episode. I don't know what it is.
I have not seen a single episode of 24.
I don't think you're missing out, but
and I did read one of my, a couple of my friends that have written Star Trek novels have now written tie-in.
Oh, sure. Novels. Okay, yeah.
Dayton Ward, Dave Mack, James Swallow, they've all written Star Trek.
And that I can see, because over the course of 9 seasons, I mean, there is a robust supporting cast. You know, there are probably a lot of stories you can tell.
And so I recently read Dave Mack's 24 novel. I haven't. So that was my first real experience of the character. I mean, I knew the basics of the show.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty simple.
But I agree with your assessment, is that one of the reasons I didn't watch the show is because when I started hearing more and more about it, and basically he's the good guy that uses torture very effectively, because in the fictional world, you always know exactly the right person to torture, and they always give you exactly the right information
effective.
You need.
It's weird.
And,
amazingly, Gordon and Ganza, like the guys who used to be on X-Files, came up with the show before 9/11 happened. So I'm just saying, like, as far as disasters that turn out to be really great for your property, like, 24 could have just hit the pond and just no ripples at all and just disappeared. But we were ready to watch Donald Sutherland's kid beat up some terrorists at that point.
Oh, yeah. You know, it appeals to, some emotions, base emotions that are sometimes very understandable and –
And the Die Hard movies suck now, so. that's a good example of a franchise that I just keep hanging on to, even though it's gone down the toilet long ago.
I haven't seen the last couple.
Oh, okay, well, there you go.
I probably will at some point, because, I love the first one, and I do tend to. My borderline obsessive compulsiveness. It's like once I start something, it's like, okay, now I have to see them all.
Watch it on the couch late at night, and then maybe you won't have to finish it. Speaking of novelizations, Keith DeCandido wrote the novelization for this, a movie. The first couple movies, I think, wrote the book versions of them.
I'd forgotten that.
Yeah. I have not read those. I'm sure they're probably entertaining, maybe a little better plotted. But... And, as far as guilty pleasures go, I think it's fine, because James Cameron says that this movie series is his guilty pleasure. Somebody asked him that a little while ago, and he's like, I like those Resident Evil movies.
They're fun.
They are fun.
Big, stupid fun.
They are. That's how I would think I would come down on this if we had to rate it. 4 big, stupid funs out of 5. Well, let's do a movie bonus round. You're a Blade Runner fan.
Oh, yes.
How do you feel about Blade Runner 2049?
Now that some of the clips I've seen... make me almost cautiously optimistic.
Okay, sure.
When it was first announced that there was going to be a sequel, I was thought, no. Right. Especially because I loathed Prometheus.
Okay. And it's funny because you liked Prometheus, or you hated Prometheus, but you liked World War Z. Both have Damon Lindelof's jam hands on them as far as writing or rewrites.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, I
speaking of a guy who loves to bury a twist for no reason, just to have something happen in the late second act.
Oh, yeah. Don't get me started on Lost. On the series finale.
Different show.
I loathe Prometheus. And so then... the idea that, okay, now he's going to go and ruin Blade Runner, too, after messing up Alien. Right. So much. But then I start seeing some of the clips, and the guy, what's his name, who's directing it?
Denis Villeneuve.
Has done solid work on other stuff. And so now I'm getting kind of hopeful. But, I do not want...
Follow-up to that, Denis Villeneuve has just been announced that he is directing the Dune remake.
And so that's very interesting.
Yes.
And certainly a property that could use another movie.
That's true. I think I've talked about this on an earlier show, but my impression of that is that he is a guy who is... I don't know if you've seen his films or a lot of his films. He's very visually arresting as a director, but he tends to be pretty light on plot and story.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember now. Run down. Do you have the list right
there? I got it in my head. He's directed Prisoners. He directed a movie called Enemy with Jake Gyllenhaal. He directed, I didn't have it in my head, but a couple things.
Did he do a kaiju movie or something? Did he do one of the big monster movies, or he's doing one of the big monster movies?
I don't think so.
Or am I having a senior moment?
Possibly. Oh, Arrival, of course. Just the recent Arrival was by him.
Yeah.
And Sicario as well. And that pretty much covers his English language,
the milieu of his oeuvre.
Movies look great, but in terms of like what they're actually delivering and like plot points and stuff. And so you've got a book that's 700, 800 pages long. I think this movie is going to really disappoint like hardcore Herbert fans. It's going to look amazing though.
2 points.
Sure.
Somewhat related in different ways to what we're saying. So first, I would also say that that's one of Ridley Scott's problems, is that he's a brilliant visual director, but he can pick scripts that are, you know, A scripts and Z scripts, and he doesn't seem to distinguish between them.
Right.
And he brings his fabulous visual stylings to whatever he does.
And I'm not sure that he even understands what the script he's doing, because he made Blade Runner, which took off, and then he's revisited that movie like 3 or 4 times and recut it. And every time he recuts it, he changes what people think about it, and he changes the intention of the film.
And then Dune as a property, this ties back into Secret Shame. I actually kind of like David Lynch's version.
Oh, sure. Yeah, no.
Even though... It's a complete mess.
Oh, yeah. It's
in a variety of ways.
Right.
and the tone. I mean, you have stuff that's very straight and great, and then suddenly you have Harkonnen with the floating fat man, with the pustules all over his face. And it's like, well, where the hell is that? That's just Lynch being a nut job, as he sometimes is.
Right.
And so, a serious big budget adaptation that goes back to the source, there's really room for that, as opposed to sometimes, you know, Hollywood will go back and remake and reboot, and sometimes it just seems like there's no reason for this because the original film has done so well, it really captured everything.
Yeah.
Where is there a need for a new take? But in this case, I think there is. I really wish that the shoot with David Lynch on Dune hadn't gone so terribly, and the struggles between him and the studio, because I so wish that he would do a director's cut.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's tons of other footage.
Right.
But, you know, there is an extended cut of that film out, but it's not a director's cut.
No, it doesn't really have his name on it. Yeah, right.
And I wish that, you know, it's such a bummer when an interesting director has a film that goes south and then they just refuse to go back to it because it was so ugly. I mean, the same thing happened with The Adventures of Baron Munchausen and Terry Gilliam.
Yeah, right.
Because, of course, every Terry Gilliam film is a troubled shoot because he's just a mad genius.
Right.
And that's another one where apparently there's lots of other footage.
Huh.
And he's, you know, just said that
he's not
going to
revisit
going back to that.
Yeah.
Whereas luckily on Brazil, we got a director's cut eventually.
But yeah.
Okay. I've gone far afield though.
Well, have you seen Hodorowski's Dune, the documentary?
I haven't seen it yet. It's on my
queue. It's really great. And
I really want
to, and you could really see, I mean, they don't really reach into the David Lynch part of the story, but you really see how daunted everybody was by this task before it even got handed over to him. But the interesting side effect, to sort of kind of ruin the documentary a little bit, is that he assembled so many different people to help him on this, and then the movie fell through, but he basically created this cross-pollination because people like Dan O'Bannon was working with this guy and this person, this designer, were met with that guy. And then so we got like Alien and Star Wars and all these other things because of the pollination that happened when he brought these people together. But yeah, it is a fascinating documentary, and it's not what we're talking about, but that's okay. We're all done. As we wrap up here, do you want to tell us where people can find you online?
They can find me at yeahsure.net. That's yeahsure.net. And from there, you will find links to Generations Geek. And I mean, there's also generationsgeek.com is the standalone website for the podcast. And you'll find all the links on there. And you can find me on Facebook and all that stuff, the social media that the kids use.
Sure. Anything coming up on the show you want to tell us about?
Let's see. The next show coming up, which I really have to get into the editing booth on soon, is just going to be a second part of a extensive interview I did with David Mack.
Oh, neat.
The first part, which is the current show, covered his work on Star Trek, his extensive work on Star Trek. He's written Star Trek comic books, Star Trek novels, a Deep Space Nine episode. He's written dialogue for Star Trek computer games, so he's worked in like every format that it's available in,
right,
except for a feature film.
Right.
And then the second part of the interview that's coming up next will cover his other work, his original novels, other tie-in fiction, and his deep, abiding love for the band Rush.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. I got to tune in for that. Rush. Wow. Okay. See that.
Well, and there was recently an anthology called 2113.
Yeah, right.
That was, so it's all fiction by various people inspired by Rush songs. Any Rush fan should check it out.
Okay.
It's really
I'm kind of fun. A closet Rush fan. I'll check that out. Well, thanks again for joining me on the show today. I want to remind my listeners, first of all, I want to admonish my listeners to go check out Generations Geek because it is a really great show and it's a lot of fun.
Is admonishing necessary?
We're going to start with that and we'll turn up the heat if we have to from there.
All right,
but I also remind the listeners that they can find us on social media, on Facebook and Twitter if you search for Just Enough Trope. If you go to iTunes and search for Just Enough Trope, you can find our iTunes show page. When you're there, I wish that you would subscribe. It's the best thing to do. It's the best way to get the show as soon as it's ready, it comes to you. And if you give us a rating, we appreciate it because we love hearing from the fans and hearing how you think we're doing. And while you're there, if you could give us a rating, a good one, hopefully, when you give us a good rating, we move up in the ranks. iTunes knows that we're doing a good job and everybody gets what they want. So give us 5 Red Queens, perhaps, creepy little English children, so we know that you think we're doing a good job.
Which is kind of redundant, really.
Yeah, it does. Actually, I really missed out on the perfect one because we should get 5 stars because that's the name of the elite police team in Raccoon City.
Oh.
You want stars? I'll give you stars. So yeah, give us 5 stars. Perfect. Thanks again for joining me on the show. It's been a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Yes, and this is your host, Caliban, signing off for guest host Scott Pearson. Keep the geek fires burning.